Scroll. Okay, girls, can someone remind us what we looked at in the last lesson in this tangent?
You are looking at
Let's
reactional.
keep our hands for order. Yes, Michelle.
We were looking at the alkali earth metals, the first group of elements in the periodic table.
Okay, alkali earth metals. What did we look at about them?
We looked at the properties.
Okay. Thank you, that is good. Anyone else? Yes, Lisa.
Yes. We're looking at the group one metals and their different reactions, like how potassium reacts more than sodium and lithium.
Okay, that is beautiful. Thank you. Then, Rebecca.
In last week's lesson, we were looking at the alkali earth metals and their different reactions. We looked at their reactions with water, and we also looked at their, we looked at them burning in air to form nitrates, and also looked at their reactions with dilute acids.
Okay, that is beautiful. Thank you. Okay. Mr. Bata, I don't know whether it's my screen, but I can't see the screen.
Students, can you see the screen? Students, can you see atomic structure?
Yes, we can.
Yes.
Yes, we can.
It's still there.
Teacher.
Yes.
Teacher Martha, are you there? Teacher Martha? Well, it's possible that Teacher Martha is not around. I'll kind of request Teacher Silverin to maybe take over as Teacher Martha returns. Yes. Teacher Silverin, are you present to help as Teacher Martha returns? I think there was a network issue.
So this is chemistry, right?
Yes, okay, Teacher Martha is back. This is chemistry, yes. I hope it's still, and I hope it looks like chemistry to you. I'm seeing electron shells and nucleus.
Mr. Martha, can you kindly scroll down? Then I'll tell you to stop, maybe.
Teacher Martha, am I still scrolling?
Yes, please. I'll let you know.
Okay, I could move a little faster. I thought it was somewhere.
Yeah. You can keep scrolling. Up to around there. Okay, keep scrolling, Mr. Bato.
Oh, I thought it was alkali earth metals. Oh, or you could tell me what I'm looking for so that.
We can stop there for now.
Okay,
thank you. So girls, sorry about the disruption. Last time with Ms. Tanjuna, we looked at the different reactions of the alkali metals, and we went into the different reactions of the alkali earth metals. And we looked at the different reactions with water, with air, and with the dilute acids. So you notice that the group two elements basically react with dilute acids. We have magnesium reacting with hydrochloric acid and sulfuric acid, and they form colorless solutions of metal salts. And that metal salt we have there is magnesium chloride, or we can have magnesium sulfate if we are having magnesium reacting with sulfuric acid plus hydrogen gas. And then we looked at how chlorine reacts with those acid as well. We saw how it reacts with calcium reacting with dilute sulfuric acid. That gives us calcium sulfate. And we know that calcium sulfate is sparingly soluble. That means it carries a state of a solid other than aqueous, like we see in magnesium. I hope you take note of that. Mr. Bato, can we move? So who can tell us why nitric acid does not react with those metals the same way sulfuric acid does and hydrochloric acid? Can someone tell us? Yes, Daphne, you can unmute.
Teacher, we never reached that part. We had stopped all oxides by al. So we hadn't yet like reached the chlorine and hydroxide stuff.
Really, but you had looked at the reaction with water, isn't it?
Yes, with water.
Okay.
We looked at alkali metals, not alkali as metals.
But I remember Ms. Tanjuna talking about alkali earth metals. Okay, we can still recap it anyway.
He looked at only group one elements.
Oh, I was remembering as if he had covered. Oh, thank you, teacher.
I thought it was group one also.
Okay, so we can go to the alkaline earth metals. We have the alkaline earth metals. We say they are group two elements, and we have beryllium, magnesium, and calcium. And under group two elements, we have basically, we saw that they are all metals, and we know that they have two electrons in their outermost shell, and that qualifies them to have a valency of 2. I hope we all remember that. And then we know that they form basic oxides due to the fact that they are metals. By basic oxides, that means they react with oxygen to give us basic oxide. Maybe we have calcium plus oxygen to give us calcium oxide, as you see down there. And then we have, they burn in oxygen with a characteristic flame colors to form white solids. And we have calcium burning with a brick red flame to form a white solid of calcium oxide. And the equation is as you see below. We have the calcium solid plus oxygen, which is a gas, to give us calcium oxide. So calcium oxide is a white solid. You should take note of that. And then we have those oxides. When they dissolve in water, you realize that they form hydroxide. And in the equation below, you see calcium oxide, which is a solid reacting with water, which is a liquid, to give us calcium hydroxide. Then we move to magnesium. Magnesium burns with a bright white flame to give us a white solid. So we have magnesium plus oxygen giving us magnesium oxide, which is a white solid. And you need to take note of the flame as well. It is a bright white flame. And since magnesium oxide is sparingly soluble in water, it will form a white suspension of magnesium hydroxide. So the fact that it is sparingly soluble, that means it will stop the reaction from going ahead. That means we'll have magnesium hydroxide, as you can see in the equations below. We have magnesium oxide reacting with water to give us magnesium hydroxide. Then we have the group two elements burn in air to form nitrides. Nitrides are formed by different elements reacting with nitrogen to give us a compound of a nitrogen. Now we have magnesium forms magnesium nitride, while calcium forms calcium nitride, and both are white solids. So we have magnesium, reacting with nitrogen to give us magnesium nitride, which is a white solid. And the same thing happens with chlorine to give us calcium nitride. You realize that we have a three on magnesium and nitrogen. Okay, can that person kindly mute their mic? Thank you. And then, girls, you have to take note that. Their mic.
Faith, please mute.
The other person hasn't.
Mr. Bato, maybe you can help me there. Thank you. So we have.
Teacher Mother, first unmute yourself. Unmute yourself. Teacher Martha, first unmute yourself so that you can hear you. I muted everyone. Teacher Martha? Teacher Martha? Teacher Mother, you can unmute now.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Bato. So, girls, you should take note that group two elements have a higher affinity for nitrogen than oxygen in the air. That means they are more likely to form compounds with nitrogen. That is very important that you take note of it. Okay, Mr. Bato, I think we can scroll downwards. I can see some hands. I don't know whether they have questions. Chasuva, maybe you can help me there.
Okay, let's let's have Lugolo Obi. Shona, you can ask your question.
Sorry, I forgot my hand.
Okay, there is no one. Let's proceed.
Okay, thank you. So next we are looking at the reactions of group two elements with water. And I think we looked at these when we were looking at the reactions of different elements with water. We can still go through it. We have magnesium reacts slowly with cold water, but very fast with steam to give us a metal oxide and hydrogen gas. And then magnesium metal is heated in the presence of steam. It catches a fire and burns with a bright white flame, forming a white solid of magnesium oxide and hydrogen. And we have magnesium reacting with steam. Steam is a gas in that case. So we have magnesium oxide and hydrogen gas. Someone in the chat is asking for the color of calcium nitride and magnesium nitride. You said they are white solids. I hope you take note of that. Then calcium quietly burns with cold water with the effervescence of a colorless gas, leaving a cloudy solution of calcium hydroxide. Most of the calcium salts are sparingly soluble, so that means they don't completely dissolve. In that case, we have calcium reacting with water to give us a sparingly soluble salt of calcium hydroxide, as you can see in the equation below. Then we have reaction with dilute acids. So in this case, we have the group two elements reacting with basically dilute hydrochloric acid and dilute sulfuric acid. So in this case, we observe that, and we shall see why they don't react with dilute nitric acid as they do with the two acids. So in this case, we have magnesium reacting with hydrochloric acid, and we have a formation of magnesium chloride plus hydrogen gas. That means magnesium reacts with dilute hydrochloric acid to give us a colorless solution of magnesium chloride and hydrogen gas. You all know how to test for hydrogen gas. I hope we still remember that. And then when it reacts with sulfuric acid, you notice that it will form magnesium sulfate and hydrogen gas. You should take note of that. Then when chlorine reacts with hydrochloric acid, the same reaction occurs as in magnesium. We'll have calcium plus hydrochloric acid to give us calcium chloride. And then we have calcium reacting with dilute sulfuric acid. This one will give us a sparingly soluble salt of calcium sulfate, which is a white solid, plus hydrogen gas. You should take note of that, girls. Mr. Bato, can we continue? Yes, so you notice that there is a difference when it comes to the reaction of calcium with sulfuric acid and then magnesium with sulfuric acid. With magnesium, you'll obtain a colorless solution of magnesium sulfate, but with calcium, since it is sparingly soluble, you'll obtain a sparingly soluble salt of calcium sulfate, which is a white precipitate. Then Can one of the girls tell us why you think nitric acid does not react as the rest of the salts do, as the rest of the acids do with the group two elements? One of the girls tell us. Yes, Kajemu, Jovia.
Because nitric acid is a powerful oxidizing agent, it starts to react with oxygen from water.
Sorry? Can you repeat?
Because nitric acid is a powerful oxidizing agent, therefore oxidizes the hydrogen to form water.
Okay. So what is an oxidizing agent? Can one of the girls tell us what an oxidizing agent is? Yes, Rebecca.
An oxidizing agent is an element that removes hydrogen from a substance.
Okay, very good. So we realize that oxidizing agents remove hydrogen but add oxygen to a given element. So we find that nitric acid is a very oxidizing agent. That means instead of giving us hydrogen gas as we've seen, in sulfuric acid and hydrochloric acid, will obtain instead water in the place of hydrogen. So that means we'll form salt and water instead of acid and hydrogen gas. So you should take note of that. Okay, Paula, do you have a question or you're giving an answer? You can unmute.
Yes, Miss, I had a question. I was very confused, you know. I think magnesium reacting with cold water slowly and then reacting with steam first. Is that what you said?
Yes.
So now I'm wondering, what if you put, how does it react with hot water?
How does it react with hot water?
Yes, not steam, but hot water.
Okay, you realize that when we are reacting these compounds, the conditions also what matter. So we are looking at the cold water, because remember, when you're having hot water, definitely it's going to produce what? Steam. So the magnesium will react with the steam. Hope that answers you.
Miss, if you put it inside, like a cup of hot water, if you put it inside, what will happen? Will it like begin to melt like faster than it would with cold water? Because I don't think there'll be steam inside the water, I think. I don't know if that makes sense.
Of course, definitely it will react with the hot water as well, but it will still form a precipitate of magnesium oxide, which will stop the reaction.
Okay, Miss, last question. Is it faster with hot water or faster with steam?
It is faster with steam. That is why we always opt for steam.
Okay, thank you, Miss.
Okay. Can we have Shona? I don't know whether you have a question.
Lisa, your hand is up. Do you have a question? Teacher Martha, I think you can look at Leticia. I don't know if she has a question. Okay, go ahead.
Yes, I was asking that does reducing and oxidizing only involve hydrogen and oxygen? Like how reduction is the addition of hydrogen? So does it not like involve anything else?
Thank you for that question. When we're looking at reduction and oxidation, you remember we're looking at addition and or removal of hydrogen, addition of oxygen or removal of hydrogen. But then those two also involve loss or gaining of what? Of electrons. When you're looking at oxidation, you're looking at the loss of electrons or removal of electrons. But when you're looking at reduction, you're looking at gaining of electrons or addition of electrons. Does that answer your question?
Yes, and then also just asking that hydrochloric acid, is it a combination of chlorine and hydrogen?
Yes, hydrochloric acid is a combination of hydrogen and chlorine elements.
Okay, thank you.
Leticia, do you have a question? Your hand is up, Leticia.
Teacher, I wanted to ask, what do you mean when we say sparingly soluble?
Sparingly soluble. Thank you, Leticia, for that question. It means the substance we are dealing with doesn't completely dissolve. That means you remain with some particles in the test tube or whatever container you're using. So sparingly soluble, that is it dissolves but not completely dissolving. You remain with some particles at the end of the reaction. I don't know whether Chasuvarine has something to add to that.
Not really. Of course, sparingly is the same as slightly, a small percentage of the substance dissolved, and the rest of it remains undissolved. I don't see any other person. I think you can go on.
Okay, thank you, Chasuvarine. So we have reaction with chlorine. So notice that both metals burn in chlorine on heating, forming white solids. We have calcium burns with a brick red flame, forming a white solid of calcium chloride. And we see in the reaction below, we have chlorine reacting with calcium. Calcium solid reacting with chlorine gas to give us calcium chloride, which is a white solid. And then we have magnesium burning in chlorine with a bright white flame, forming a white solid of magnesium chloride. In that case, we have magnesium reacting with chlorine to give us a white solid of magnesium chloride. I hope you really take note of those colors, the colors of the different substances that we are forming. Unless we have questions, we are moving to the halogen groups or group 7 elements.
Okay, Joe, are you okay? I can see your hand up. Can you ask your question if you have one?
Just, and I think you can ask them to unmute because there is that option of them not muting themselves.
Okay, Joanna, unmute yourself and ask your question.
Okay, teacher, just to add on what Leticia said, is something that is sparingly soluble going to act like a saturated solution?
Let me ask you a question, Leticia. Oh, sorry, who asked?
Johanna.
Okay, Johanna, that is a beautiful question, but I'll ask you a question as well. What is a saturated solution?
I don't remember the exact definition, but I can give an example of, let me say, if sugar has been put in, a lot of sugar has been put in water, the solute does not totally dissolve. I mean, yeah, the solute.
Okay. Someone give us the definition of a saturated solution, girls.
Jovia, do you have an answer? And you give us an answer for saturated fruit, and then you ask your question as well. You can unmute yourself.
A saturated solution is one that cannot dissolve any more solute because of the presence of an undissolved solute. A saturated solution is a solution that cannot dissolve any more solute because of the presence of undissolved solute. And also, teacher is also asking what is electropositivity and electronegativity.
Okay, to answer Johanna's question, thank you, Jovia, for the answer and the question. When you look at the sparingly soluble, we've said it's most of it dissolves and some of it remains, the least percentage remains. But when you're looking at a saturated solution, you're looking at a solution as a general solution. I don't know whether I'm bringing it out in the right language. But then when you're looking at the sparingly soluble, we are looking at that substance, which is calcium sulfate. When you're looking at calcium sulfate, it is a solid basically, because at the end of the day, we shall remain with some particles in the solution. I don't know whether that brings it out clearly. Maybe Teacher Silverine can help me.
Okay, I think she needs to note that when you talk of a saturated solution, usually the substance must be soluble. After dissolving at that given temperature, it ceases to dissolve anymore. So it forms what we call a saturated solution. But when you say a substance is sparingly soluble, it means that substance is not very soluble in water. Even if you added a lot of it, it will still remain undissolved. I think you need to take note that the two terms are completely different. They are not related.
Okay.
Okay, can we move on?
Leticia, I think, had a question. Leticia, can you unmute and ask your question? Okay, Jovia, do you have a question? You can unmute yourself and ask your question, Jovia.
Yes, teacher. I was asking, what is electropositivity and what is electronegativity?
Wow, those words seem to be quite ahead of you. But when you talk of electropositivity, we are looking at the ability of an element to lose electrons and become positively charged. So it mainly applies to metals. We can say metals are electropositive because they lose electrons and become positively charged. Then electronegative is the opposite of electropositivity. Electronegativity, it means the ability of an element to gain electrons and becomes negatively charged, and become negatively charged. So though the terms are not so common at O level, we don't use them a lot at O level. Teacher Martha, I think you can go ahead. I don't see any other person putting up their hand.
Oh, excuse me. Paula, do you have a question? Paula, do you have a question? Unmute yourself and ask.
Yes, Miss, I have a question. Can you hear me?
Yes, I do.
Miss, my question was, in biology, they say don't describe a word using a word. So in chemistry, what if you describe a word using a word? Is that right or wrong?
What do you mean describing a word using a word? Give us an example.
Like an example would be like electropositivity. If you are describing electropositivity and you said this is where an electron is positive, is that wrong? I know the description isn't right, but is the idea of using the words you are given to describe the word, is it right?
I said electropositivity, the big means electrons. Those are the words that you are expected to use.
Yes, Miss, I know the description wasn't correct, but what I'm asking is if I describe as something like that in that way and the description is correct, but I use the words I was given to describe what I'm supposed to describe, is it right?
It depends on the context, I should say, what you're describing.
Okay, Miss, an example would be there was a description I got for a Bunsen burner, which was a Bunsen burner is a burner that burns Bunsenically in a Bunsenic form. If you describe something like that, is it correct?
Of course, that is not correct. So it generally depends on what you.
Miss, I didn't get that. Please, may you repeat?
I said, looking at that description where you're saying a Bunsen burner is a burner that burns, it is not appropriate. We have a better way of describing a Bunsen burner. That's why I said it depends on the context that you are looking at.
Okay, thank you, Miss.
Okay, thank you, Teacher Sumara. I was looking at some questions here in the chat, and someone was asking why are we continuously mentioning calcium and magnesium and beryllium is not surfacing anywhere. Girls, I want us to understand that reactivity in group two increases down the group. So you notice that. So you notice that as the beryllium, yes, reacts, but its reactions are a bit different from those in group two elements, though some are similar. So you notice that as reactivity decreases down the group, and we are looking at the first 20 elements in group two, we are basically focusing on calcium and magnesium. I hope that answers the girl that asked. Then we had another one. Do group two elements react in air to form only nitrides and not oxides? I said they have a higher affinity for nitrogen when they react with air than oxygen. That means they will have a higher percentage of reacting with nitrogen than with oxygen. But when they burn in oxygen, obviously they will have to produce oxides. I hope that answers the girl that asked as well. Then lastly, we had nitric acid oxidizes hydrogen formed to water. Does that mean that elements originally have hydrogen? I said nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. That means it oxidizes the hydrogen to give us water. In that case, it means that instead of us forming hydrogen like we're forming on sulfuric acid and dilute hydrochloric acid, in this case, we'll have water as the product instead of hydrogen. I hope that also answers the girl that asked that one. So unless Chasuvarin, you have something to add to that, we can proceed.
So if she's asking where the hydrogen comes from, this should be a displacement reaction. Now, displacement reactions, we will talk about them. We talked about them when we are looking at reactivity. If you get a metal reacting with an acid, the metal takes up the place of the hydrogen in the acid. So that is why hydrogen is given off as a gas when any metal reacts with an acid. Now, in this case, instead of getting that hydrogen, we're using nitric acid. Nitric acid will go ahead and make that hydrogen to become water instead of it remaining as hydrogen. And maybe I should emphasize to the girls, while we are looking at these reactions, they need to take note of writing the word equation. How do you write the word equation? Because that is what we examine until we will be in position to write the chemical equations, the formula and symbol.
Okay, thank you, teacher. So we are looking at halogens, and we know that halogens are group 7 elements. So we have fluorine, chlorine, bromine, and iodine. So that word halogen comes from the fact that these elements usually react as halogens to give us salts. They react with metals, to give us salts. So in that case, we call them salt makers. So we have those elements, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, and iodine, and we saw their positions in the periodic table. Can someone remind me the atomic number of fluorine? What is the atomic number of fluorine? Silverine, are there some hands? Okay, let's have Laura. You can unmute.
2 to 7.
Atomic number, not electronic configuration. Let's have Charity unmute.
17. Chlorine has an atomic number of 17.
Can we kindly unmute? I don't know whether. Okay, so you say atomic number. Getting feedback. I don't know whose mic is open. Okay, so we have. We said atomic number is the total number of protons in the nucleus of an atom. And we know that fluorine has an atomic number or number of protons as 9, chlorine 17, bromine 35, and then iodine 53. So the electronic configurations, since we are looking at the first 20 elements, you'll notice in the table on your screen, we have those of fluorine and chlorine. And we have 2 to 7 for fluorine, 2 to 8 to 7 for chlorine to give us the 17. So we looked at the valences, and the valences of group 7 elements or the halogens is 1. Can someone remind me why the valency of group 7 elements is 1?
Nasimba, can you give us an answer to the question? You can unmute yourself and give the answer.
Right, because it gains one electron to make its outermost energy level full.
Okay. Good, thank you, Berita. So I hope we all remember that it requires one electron in order to have a stable configuration or to have a stable outermost energy shell. Okay, so we noticed that most of those halogens are actually all the halogens are nonmetals. So we are going to look at the different reactions of those halogens. Mr. Bato, can you kindly scroll down? Thank you. So we have the halogens are all nonmetals, and we see that their melting and boiling points increase with increase in atomic number. Can someone tell us why that is so? Why do their boiling points and melting points increase with increase in atomic number?
Lunkuse, do you have an answer for that question? Hello, Daniela. You can unmute yourself and give us the answer. See, some of these are just putting up down their hands. Jovia, unmute and give us the answer.
I think their boiling points increase because they add an outermost energy level stronger group, and therefore I don't know.
Okay, thank you, Jovia. Can we have someone else?
Okay. Buyinza, I can see your hand up. Or Daphne, can you unmute Daphne and give us the answer?
Yeah, it is because the atomic size increases as you go down the group. So that's, if the size increases, even the boiling point has to increase. That's what I think.
Okay.
Another person?
Yes, let's have one more, maybe.
Okay, Deborah, I can see your hand up. Can you unmute and give us your answer?
Yeah, physical state changes from gas to solid as you go down the group. I had the same, both the same.
Sorry, I didn't get what you said.
Yeah, physical state changes from gas to solid as you go down the group.
Okay, is that the reason for melting and boiling point increasing? Okay, thank you girls for your contributions. So we noticed that as we go down the group, the atomic number is increasing. We have 9, 17, and so on. So you notice that the atomic size is as well increasing. And that means that since these are nonmetals, they have weak intermolecular forces holding their molecules together. So once the atomic number is smaller, like the one in fluorine, those forces of attraction can easily be overcome. But as the atomic number progressively increases, you realize that those weak van der Waals forces also become stronger. And you realize that it is not easy to overcome them unless there is increase in boiling or melting points. I hope you take note of that. Then we have at room temperature, fluorine is a pale yellow gas. Chlorine is greenish yellow. bromine is red, is a red liquid. Iodine is a black solid. That statement is just helping us distinguish the different states of those different gases, of those different elements in group 7. And you can see in the table, we have at room temperature, fluorine is a gas. Fluorine is a gas. Then bromine is a liquid and iodine is a solid. But this only happens when these elements are being viewed at a point of them being at room temperature. So at room temperature, we have fluorine, chlorine, bromine, and iodine at those different states. But once the temperatures are increased, you notice that all of them are gases at high temperatures.
Teacher Martha, kindly unmute yourself.
Thank you, Mr. Bato. Another thing you need to note is these elements are diatomic molecules. They exist as diatomic molecules. Like, for example, you notice chlorine in that equation where we have the equation of chlorine reacting with hydrogen. You notice that chlorine has a 2 on it. It exists as a diatomic atom. So it has 2 molecules in it, 2 atoms in it, sorry.
Teacher Martha.
Yes,
teacher. I think we can get a few questions from the girls and wind up. It's already time almost.
Oh, okay.
Kobu Sinje Michelle, you can ask.
I wanted to ask, on the second table, it said that the electronic configuration of bromine was 2 to 8 to 8 to 7, which means its number of protons are 25. But then in the first table, it said its number of protons was 35. So is this a mistake?
Sorry, can you repeat your question?
Like the table that's showing there, it says that electronic configuration of bromine is 2 to 8 to 8 to 7, which means its number of protons are 25. But then in the first table, it's the number of protons are 35.
That is what we are focusing basically on the configurations of chlorine and fluorine, but when you're writing the configuration of bromine, it should be able to give you 35. So you write considering the atomic number, you write the electronic configuration considering the atomic number. I hope that answers your question.
Configuration for bromine, they should be blank because we don't expect them to be.
Yes, that's what I was trying to communicate. Thank you, Mr. Silver. Another question?
Teacher, can you please help me points increase on the group with increasing?
I didn't get that question. Can you say it again? I don't know. I think we can get another person asking the question. Leticia? Unmute and ask your question.
Excuse me, teacher, how do we get to know that an element is diatomic?
Teacher Martha, are you responding to that question first?
Yes, just over it. Diatomic, we know that, first of all, you need to find out what the atomic molecules are. We have several categories of molecules. We have the monatomic, those ones exist as single atoms. And then we have the diatomic, which exist as molecules that, okay, molecules. So you notice that most of the gases actually will exist as the atomic molecules. You've been looking at oxygen, you know how it is written. You've been looking at hydrogen, you know how it is written. And then when we come to the group 7, you notice that all of them exist as the atomic molecules. I don't know whether it's just over something to add to that.
Not really. I don't know if she still has a question. Maybe we can get another question. Jovia, unmute yourself and ask a question.
Yes, so I was asking, are all like elements except the one the group 1 and group 0 transition elements?
Beg your pardon?
Are all the elements except the ones in group 1 and group 0 transition elements?
Teacher Mas, are you responding to that question?
When we have, Jovia, when we are looking at transition elements, I remember Mrs. Camp-Murray demarcated for you that area where those transition elements are found. And you notice that they are found in the deep valley of the periodic table. We have on the left-hand side, we have group 1 and group 2. And then on the right, you have group 3 to group 8. So those elements that exist in the middle of group 2 and group 3, that deep valley there, those are the ones we call transition elements. I don't know if Teacher Severin can add something to that, but that's what I think.
Not really, but she needs to look at, I hope, Jovia, do you have a chemistry textbook with you? Jovia, do you have any chemistry textbook with you? Get at the back of any chemistry textbook, you'll see a complete periodic table, and they will show you where the transition elements are. But like she said, the elements between group 2 and group 3 are the ones that we refer to as transition elements. I think we have the last question from Buyinza. Can you unmute yourself? And we'll close with that one, I think. Buyinza? Wins, are you still there? I think,
teacher, you said you teacher, one of the bromine and iodine are halogens, and you said that the valency of the halogens is 1, and in the outermost energy level, and in the outermost energy level, it's the outermost energy level has 7 electrons, but then why is it that bromine and iodine have one in each of the outermost energy levels, and also iodine has 3 in the outermost energy level?
Teacher Martha, are you responding to that question?
Maybe you can help me there, Chasovan.
I don't know where the young lady has seen that iodine has 3 and bromine has 1,
because when you're writing that electronic configuration, they should also be ending 7. But we said, do not bother yourself with writing the electronic configuration of those two, because they are past the 20 elements that we are supposed to be writing electronic configurations for. So if you, the important thing that you need to note there, we said group 7 elements have 7 electrons in the outermost energy level. And because they have 7, that means they need one electron to be stable. That is why their valence is 1. So the only thing that we need to know about iodine and bromine is their valence is 1, just like the other members of group 7. Don't bother with writing the electronic configurations. I think that's it, Samantha.
Okay, thank you, Teacher Silvery. Thank you, Mr. Butter, for hosting us and the girls. There were some questions in the chat, but I think I'll respond to them in the Google Classroom because we've run out of time. Thank you so much. Have a blessed day.